Hunter S. Thompson once said that, "He who is taught by himself has a fool for a master." Judged by this standard, the leaders in my original research were no fools. They each made themselves very open to coaching. When we think of leadership coaching, we usually think of two people in a private conversation behind closed doors. In contrast, what these leaders spoke about was something very different. I liken the leader's experience to the captain of a sporting team who receives coaching from a variety of sources beyond the head coach. The coaching takes place in both public and private forums, and there is almost always a clear distinction between the roles of captain and coach. The leaders identified three distinct groups of coaches who accelerated their transformation. I liken my role in coaching these leaders to the football equivalent of a head coach. One of the key elements these leaders spoke about was of my perceived content expertise, or what I refer to as the playbook. They spoke of benefiting from thought leadership and strategic thinking, and being provided useful insights and tools. The paradox here is this highly treasured playbook was initially more like a brochure. It was and remains a work in progress and has actually been developed with their help. What they seemed to value even more than the playbook was how it was put into action. As legendary basketball coach John Wooden once said, a coach is someone who can give correction without causing resentment. Each of the leaders revealed that receiving very direct and confronting feedback was a crucial part of their transformation. One leader told me that they found my direct coaching really interruptive to their bad habits. They said that if they were left to their own devices, it would have taken them 15 years to never to make the changes that those interventions created in a couple of giant strides. Now, whilst this very direct coaching was well received by the leaders, it was delivered within a very specific context. Firstly, I had established permission for direct coaching well in advance of giving it. Secondly, my relationships with these leaders was built on very high levels of trust. That is, in their eyes, I had perceived credibility, demonstrated integrity, and assumed good intent. Like in football, a captain's effectiveness is really dependent upon the support of their team members. Each of the leaders felt they could not have transformed without the contribution of their colleagues. One claimed, "The feedback from my team really helped fuel the fire for my journey." Another said, "My team gave me example after example of my impact. I had nowhere to hide." There is one more stakeholder that the leaders identified, their families. I liken this to the football equivalent of supporters. Now, we generally think of supporters passionately cheering their team on, and this was certainly the case here as well. But supporters often criticise their teams too. One leader told me that when he showed his wife his first brutal feedback, she said, "That looks about right. You can be a real dickhead." Another told me that a major turning point in his journey was when his teenage kids rebelled against his authoritarian parenting style. Based on my learnings from the original research, I now encourage involvement from all three stakeholder groups in the respective leader's journey, that is, consultants, colleagues, and family. I have also learned that the coaching is most powerful when all three groups identify mutually beneficial outcomes from the leader's transformation and create a trusting environment for that coaching to take place.